to me, that is partly where the L in goals comes into play, the love. Hopefully people are lucky enough to have somebody in their life who says, go for it. You can feel better. I want you to feel better. Let's try this. You know, someone who can believe in us and believe in our health and our well-being enough to encourage us to shoot for a little more.
Cue music. Places, everybody, places. We're starting in 3, 2.
Welcome to the Autoimmune Hour, where we look at the rise of autoimmune disorders. I've brought together top experts that range from doctors, specialists, nutritionists, researchers, and even those recovering from autoimmune to bring you the latest, most up-to-date information about autoimmunity and how to live your life uninterrupted.
Thank you for joining us here on the Autoimmune Hour with Sharon Sayler. Always seek sound legal, medical, and or professional advice regarding any problems, conditions, and any of the recommendations you see, hear, or read here on the Autoimmune Hour, Understanding Autoimmune and Life Interrupted Radio. And we don't want you to worry about taking too many notes, so you can join the Autoimmune Hour's Courage Club, and we'll send you the transcripts and show notes from every episode. Sign up now at understandingautoimmune.com. Now, back to your host, Sharon Sayler.
Welcome, everyone, to the Autoimmune Hour. I'm Sharon Sayler from SharonSaylor.com, and as always, it's my honor and pleasure to be with you here on another brand new episode. I am so excited. This is a topic that I love to hear on because I'm always trying to draw on it myself. We're going to talk about resilience, grounding, staying in touch with ourselves, exploring ourselves, all sorts of really good stuff here to understand. One of the things I've learned in interviewing over 300 people for the show is that it's more than just the physical part about it. It's more than just the rash or the muscle ache or whatever your diagnosis has in it. It's more than that. It goes a lot deeper in the healing and the wellness and the optimization. And regardless of what your diagnosis is, tonight is a great show because even if you don't have a diagnosis of an autoimmune, you're just awesome and great. You can use the amazing things that Dr. Lise Deguire has taught us in her brand new book called Flashback Girl, Lessons on Resilience from a Burn Survivor. It's a riveting tale. It's a riveting story. And I want to jump right in so we have all this time with her because she's just full of wisdom on everything she's learned. And what's fascinating about her story is so much of it, I'm going to say, was learned the hard way. So, Lise, I read one of your blog posts and I was so fascinated, and I can't imagine, you called it trolling yourself on the internet. I don't think that's called trolling. I maybe spying on myself on the internet. But anyway, and you found a picture of a young you, the burn survivor, on a congressional posting of some sort. I'm like, gosh, I can't imagine all of the things that would go through one's mind when that happened.
Yes. And well, first of all, thank you so much for having me here today. I'm really glad to be with you and your audience. The thing that kind of got me started writing this memoir is that I happened to be on the internet trying to understand a little bit more about the fire that I was in 50 years ago. And I mean, I can go into it in more depth, but what you're alluding to there is that I came across a picture of myself, the age of 4. I'm not identified in this picture. And in fact, my eyes are covered with a black band. But anybody out there who is burned will know. And intuitively, if you think about it, you'll know. Nobody's burned the same way.
Yeah.
So your own pattern of burns is as unique as fingerprints. No one will ever have the same ones. And I saw this picture of this little burn girl and I thought, my God, that's me. And it turned out that the lawyer that I had presented my case in front of the United States Senate. They were doing hearings on the law that eventually became the Consumer Protection Act of 1972. And my case, I was referred to as case number 1. And I found that, I'm like, oh my God, I had no idea. And I found that out 50 years later.
I'm not making light of, I just can't imagine what that would be like 50 years later. And I have to say, What an amazing law to be attached to. It's been a very valuable law to be attached to.
Yes.
However, the circumstances for getting there are just horrific.
Yes, I'm very glad to be attached to that law. I mean, I'm not, my name is not mentioned, but I know it's me because I also know that was my lawyer. And again, no one is burned the same way. And it is kind of cool to know that I'm attached to this law that has protected, God knows how many Americans that law has protected over time.
Oh my goodness. Yes, absolutely. Now, you were only 4 when this tragic incident happened. And there again, I can't imagine a little 4-year-old or growing up. I have young grandchildren, have children of my own. I can't imagine processing any of that. But during this entire time, you learned so many what I'll call coping skills and resilience skills and things like that, that you weave into not only your memoir, but in all your work that you share with people about understanding, look, you can get through this, is the premise I take away from what I've been reading about your work.
Exactly so. I come at my work now, certainly I come from my book, from the perspective of 2 things. I am a survivor. I am a survivor of many horrific things, which we can get into if you want. I am a survivor of many horrific things. And I am also a healthcare provider and writer. And it is very much my belief that people can survive terrible, terrible, terrible things. And that although in the middle of it, you might feel you won't survive. And in the middle of knowing somebody who's going through something terrible, you might think, oh my God, what's gonna happen to this person? It's really important to have hope. And I don't mean kind of like fake hope. I mean like real sincere hope that in the knowledge that things pass and you can get better. And if you need help, there's help out there. And if you need help, you should get help. And you too, like me, can build yourself a beautiful life despite horrific circumstances. There was a time that you would definitely have considered me the most unfortunate girl you'd ever seen, no question. And now I have a really lovely life that I think most people would look at and say, wow, what a great life. And no one would have guessed that would have happened, but that happened for me and that can happen for, I don't wanna say everyone, maybe it can't happen for everyone, but it can happen for a lot of people.
Right. Absolutely. And I didn't mention that you're a clinical psychologist in private practice. If people are wondering, what kind of doctor is she?
Yeah.
So you actually help a lot of people understand this power of hope and faith and resilience.
Yes.
And in reading your work, what are your top tips about resilience? Because I think a lot of people, I remember you just mentioned sort of this fake hope versus, like a deep knowing type of hope. And those are critical, important differences to me, because when I was at the height of my diagnosis, I'd actually lost 60% of my skin. There again, not from a burn, just from the medical condition, the skin peeled off. And I think that part of me related to your story in that way of like, okay, well, wow, what now? What next? Where do we go from here? And I think one of my fascinations about your story is how you chose resilience to be part of your life's work. So tell us, what are some of the top things that you've discovered about people who you say that's a resilient person?
Mm-hmm. In the course of writing and what I've been doing, I've started to speak various different places. And what I do is I start with talking about my own personal story of what I've been through, and then I move into a general discussion about resilience, what it is, and how we can improve our capacity for it. Just to kind of start there, resilience is often defined as the ability to bounce back. And I think it's important to start there because to be resilient, sort of 2 things have to have happened. One, you have to have been through something horrible, right? If you haven't been through something horrible, you're not resilient. You're like, doing good. Resilient people have been through something awful. And then the second part is they've had a positive recovery. They've bounced back from it. And many people would say they bounce back stronger, resilient people. I've researched this and read a lot about it. And there's a number of factors about resilience that they're inborn or they're just given to us and we cannot control. And then there's a number of factors that we can work on. So things that we can't control are genetics. There's a genetic predisposition for resiliency. Economic assets help with resiliency. They certainly help you get more help and maybe keep you in a safer neighborhood and safer schools, things like that. So those aren't the issues of resilience I'm talking about. We may not have much control over those. But the things we can work on, I've come up with a mnemonic. It's goals plus M&M. It used to just be goals, and I really liked that. And then I realized I had to add in M&M, so bear with me. So,
because whenever I hear M&M, I think of the little cartoon characters.
right. So the G in goals stands for gratitude. O is optimism. A is active coping. L is love. S is social skills. And M&M stands for meaning making. And I can get into any of that if you want me to, or we can leave that there. I want to leave that to you.
Oh, absolutely. No, I was fascinated by the resilience part because as my experience as I was going through this, and I've had other traumas in my life, I think nobody escapes trauma free, but this one in particular, I wasn't sure I was resilient until a few years down the road and I looked back. Yes. I didn't know I was doing resilience as I was trying to change course and change direction of my health and my well-being and all of that. I was just taking one step at a time. What's the next logical thing to do here? And is that something that you find that people, well, I didn't know I was resilient until I looked back?
Right. Well, I think as you're describing it, though, you were being resilient in that moment.
But I wasn't trying to be resilient. I don't know if that makes any sense. I wasn't consciously going, oh, I'm going to be resilient.
Yeah. And I think there's sort of there's a bounce back with resiliency. You go down and then you come up again. And you don't come up again right away. One of the things I'm always very clear when I talk about with people is like, you don't get to just do this. Like, what, right? And a lot of times when a person is going through something terrible, the only thing you can do at that time is just get through the day.
Yes, get through the day. The question that people would say, what are your plans? And I'm like, the next 2 minutes, breathe and get comfortable or something. It was that basic was, don't ask me my plans because I don't know anything beyond this moment.
Right. And I think with a lot of physical problems, I mean, my burns, and I'm sure many of the people that are listening here with autoimmune disorders, with a lot of these problems, there are some days that all you can say is like, okay, I brushed my teeth and I ate and now I'm going to sleep. And and that, I don't want to say it's a good day, but you got through it. So I think I'm always very wary when people talk about like, I've heard people say like, be resilient, like, that's not something you can just rush. Some days you just have to get through, but there's a mindset to how you get through them, right? The O, optimism. Sometimes an optimistic mindset for a day when you're really suffering is, I can make it through this day.
And even more basic, if I can share, is just simple things that you already know. I know that if I rest, that every previous time allowed myself to rest, I have felt better the next day. So even just reminding myself of the successes I'd had before, as simple as it's okay, just cancel things and rest.
Right.
I think giving myself permission was part of the goals. I don't know if giving myself permission is a goal, but to me, sometimes I had to give myself permission to just not do everything for everybody like most moms and business people do.
Right. But I would say that's part of my little thing for goals, because that's active coping. So the A in goals stands for active coping, and that's the ability to take a look at a situation, the situation that you're in, and to discern the things you have control over versus the things that you don't. So to take, we'll take the analogy of your health. You don't have control over the diagnosis you have. You have it. What do you have control over? You have control over how you're going to spend your day. And you have control over the decision that maybe some things can wait. And maybe the most important thing right now is to rest. That's active coping. I mean, you know, you're not going to see it on a plaque somewhere, but that is actually active coping. It's taking a look at a situation and saying, what is it in here that I can do something about, figuring it out and doing it.
Well, because one of the things we talk here on the Autoimmune Hour about is just do one thing to optimize every day.
Yes.
And it can be a small thing. It can be a big, profound thing. That's not the point. The size is not the point, but just do one thing to optimize every day. And thanks to the compounding effect of math, it builds upon itself. And I love that idea that you talk about active coping. I think people hear the word coping and they give it a negative spin on it. Too many times when I hear people talk about, oh, that's a coping mechanism, or I'm just trying to get through, it somehow diminishes all the effort that is required and all the things that are required to continue to optimize, continue to have hope that your health will get better, even with tiny little baby steps.
Yes, right. And I think there's a lot about resilience that it is very much about your mindset. Don't you think?
Oh, I do.
I have worked with people who are intensely pessimistic people, and God bless them. They often don't make good choices because all of these things can kind of spiral together. If you are pessimistic, you might think that there is no hope. And then you might think, well, why should I bother doing that exercise I'm supposed to do? Or why should I bother following up with the doctor? And then if you're in that mindset, you won't notice the things, the G in goals, the gratitude, that the things that you could be grateful for. And then as you spiral downwards, feeling more and more pessimistic, you may not, unfortunately, people may not be coming to your assistant as much because they might feel like, oh boy, she's in such a slump, or, you know, she's not doing what she can do to help herself. And all these things can kind of spiral downward, or, you know, positively, they can spiral upward.
Oh, absolutely.
Can I say that?
Yeah. And I'm curious about this weird place that I hear about. I've been there on occasion and I have to stop and sometimes reevaluate going, oh, I'm there. Where I call it stuck in comfortable enough. That's not an acronym or anything, guys. It's just kind of what I call it, where maybe there is a new medication and you read all the side effects and boy, that seems a little scary. And you're like going, I'm not slipping backwards, but you know, it's where I say people can get stuck in this place of, well, this is better than where I was. Yeah. And it may not be perfect, but I'm that big C word, coping here.
Yeah. Yeah.
How can we keep moving forward when we find ourselves getting into that place of, well, gosh, this is good enough?
To me, that is partly where the L in goals comes into play, the love. You know, hopefully people are lucky enough to have somebody in their life who says, go for it. You can feel better. I want you to feel better. Let's try this. You know, someone who can believe in us and believe in our health and our well-being enough to encourage us to shoot for a little more.
I love that. Shoot for a little more. And I like that little more too, because oftentimes that little more can feel like a huge leap to be someone who's stuck in that place of, oh, I've been through so much. I'm so tired. And it's not too bad here. Sort of like choosing this place where you want to stay. You're like, okay, I'll just accept this what is. So I love that. And let's talk a little bit. Oh, I see that I don't want to blow past this quick commercial break with Dr. Lise. I just lose all track of time here. So we got to take a quick commercial break. When we come back, we'll talk some more with her about resilience and also about grounding and all sorts of other ways of coping and mechanisms. We'll be right back.
Life Interrupted Radio will return after these messages from our sponsors. It's great sponsors like these that keep this show coming to you every week. Be sure and stop by lifeinterruptedradio.com to learn more.
Your conscious lifestyle on steroids. OMTimes Radio. IOM FM.
Hello, I'm Lisa Berry. Join me every Monday at 1 p.m. Eastern Time for Light on Living. A chance to see new, hear different, and feel more as I shine the spotlight on all the ways to lighten the load of life's challenges. Light on Living is your link to that new way you're looking for, that new understanding that will enhance your life, and that positive connection that will support your growth. So join me, and you'll gain insight and start to see things in a new way that motivates you.
OMTimes Magazine is one of the leading online content providers of positivity, wellness, and personal empowerment. A philanthropic organization, their net proceeds are funneled to support worldwide charity initiatives via Humanity Healing International. Through their commitment to creating community and providing conscious content, they aspire to uplift humanity on a global scale. OMTimes, co-creating a more conscious lifestyle.
Listen and imagine. It takes 5 seconds to send a text, and for those 5 seconds, you're driving blind.
Life is worth more than a text.
Stay alive. Don't text and drive.
Visit StopTextStopWrecks.org, a message brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, Project Yellow Light, Noise, and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Sharon, and of course you know me from here on the Autoimmune Hour. Maybe you don't know I'm also an author. My latest book is for kids. It's Pinky Chenille and the Rainbow Hunters, a winner of a 5-star reader's favorite review. It's perfect for your early reader and a great bedtime story for your young adventurers. Check it out over at pinkychenille.com. That's PinkyChenille.com. See you there. Welcome back, everyone, to the Autoimmune Hour. I'm Sharon Sayler from SharonSayler.com, and tonight we're talking resilience. We're talking coping mechanisms. We're talking optimism, hope, and love, as well as we're going to get into some grounding tips, which I just love, because right now in the chaos in the world, I think we need all of those things that we were just talking about. And our guest is an expert in this. Her name is Dr. Lise Deguire, and she's a clinical psychologist in private practice. And she is an amazing author of the book called Flashback Girl, Lessons on Resilience from a Burn Survivor. She survived just a horrific burn experience. And we can get her to share a little bit on that if she'd like. And it helps people learn about resilience issues. And she's also a nationally known keynote speaker. But Dr. Lise, I wanted to get into more about this idea of resilience. And you talk about social skills as well. And that's the S in her goals. We've talked about gratitude a little bit. I want to swing back on that some because we just briefly have gone over gratitude, optimism, active coping, love, and social skills. But what do you mean when you say social skills? Because a lot of people don't think about healing or recovery and resilience and social skills.
Yes. However, I will say that the research on people who are blessed with resilience or who have cultivated resilience tend to be people who are really good with other people.
That's interesting. I would never have made the correlation.
Well, think about what being good with other people brings you. It brings you support.
And you know, another thing it brings me is empathy. It brings me connection. Yeah, it brings me a lot of things. It brings me introspection. And
I know for myself, I came from a family, my parents, and God bless them. They did what they knew how to do, and they did the best that they had to give me. But they were both really self-absorbed, pretty narcissistic people. And my mother in particular did a lot of damage. So I didn't come from a family where I really had my parents behind me. I mean, they meant to be, but they were not. But I always had very good social skills. I have always been very friendly and outgoing and smiley and cheerful. And so I have made it through the world by making friends. I am still in touch with my first grade best friend, my fourth grade best friend. I can go on and on and on. That is who carried me through decades of trauma. So that's what social skills did for me. And that's what social skills do for a lot of people, right? Say you're in the hospital with some terrible condition. There are people who are in the hospital who are very careful to smile at the nurse when they come in, to say please and thank you and I so appreciate your help. And then there are people in the hospital who forget to do those things, or maybe they don't know how to do those things. And hopefully you have a staff that is professional enough to treat both people the same. But who do you think their bell's gonna get answered a little faster? Who do you think's gonna get that extra help? It's the person who makes the staff feel good. So social skills are very powerful.
Yeah, that old saying about treat others how you want to be treated really comes into play here. Although, and I'm not making it an excuse for it, but oftentimes when you're feeling pretty crummy and in pain, it's hard to put a smile on your face.
I know. I don't say it lightly. I really actually do understand that. Yeah. I think people with good social skills cannot take it out on other people anyway.
Yeah, the great point. Great point. Yeah, I think that's the key point, because I know a few times it just hurt for people to touch me, to move me, as I'm sure being a burn survivor, as such a self-aware of that. Can't always, sometimes the friendliest things don't come out of your mouth at those times.
Yep, I hear you.
But as long as those words weren't pointed at anybody, sometimes those words really made me feel better.
Yes, right.
Oh my gosh. So let's talk a little bit more about some of the things that you've noticed in all of your studies of resilience. We've talked about hope and these types of things. We can circle back onto all of the different parts of goals, but what are some actual types of things that we can start today? Like, I know you mentioned things like journaling and things like that. What are some things that you have found help people that somebody could start today?
So I feel like we're moving into a different mnemonic that I developed. Is that right?
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. So around the time when COVID started, and let me just say, this is a year that requires resilience from like every single person. You know, I've never lived a year where everybody I know is having an awful time. You know, normally there's some people who are having an awful time and some people are having like a good year. Like nobody's having a good year. Everybody's having some version of this is awful. So around the time that COVID started, I write this blog and I write it about resilience, every other week. And I came up with this thing, a sort of a grounding framework that I was suggesting that people consider to help them get through these COVID days. And maybe you wouldn't have time for all five of these things every day, but if you do have time for all five of them every day, I do think they improve the quality of your day. The acronym for this is MECCA, M-E-C-C-A. And the M stands for meditate, taking some time to meditate every day. I do this every morning. And the E stands for exercise. And now I grant you, some people can exercise and run a marathon. And for some people, exercising is standing up. But whatever your E is, doing that. The C stands for create. I started playing the piano again during COVID. Whatever creation is for you. Some people creating is cooking or writing. Or, Pinterest.
I had to, I had a friend who's a beautiful, actual, earns a living as an artist, and she started a Facebook group and now teaches little creativity Facebook lives. And I love joining those, even though that's not one of the things I would, a label I'd particularly give myself, but learning something new instead of taking something, of course, I'm doing some things that I had forgotten to do or whatever, but I just love also learning something new.
Yes, yes, yes.
I find that very creative.
Yes, you're just challenging the mind in some way that's different, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely. And it's and choosing something that I probably in other times would have been too busy to choose. I can't say I wouldn't have chosen it. I just would have made excuses not to choose it.
I hear you. Yes.
I'll just
finish up those five things. So the second C is connect. And by connect, I was meaning, you know, talking to a friend you haven't talked to for a while, or going out in the street and saying hi to a neighbor, but some form of connection. And then the A was accomplish. So during my early COVID days, for example, I decided it was high time I cleaned the windows in my house. And I am embarrassed to tell you how many years it had been since I cleaned the windows in my house.
I'm nodding in agreement with that one. We just went through wildfires just 3 miles from the house, and the last couple of days air has been clear enough to actually be outside, and I was looking at those windows going, oh my gosh, I didn't realize Soot and Ash could make those windows look like that. So nodding in agreement on that one.
Where are you in California? Are you in California, I assume?
Actually, we're in Oregon here.
Oh, yeah. Beautiful, but I'm sure it's not so feeling so beautiful right now.
Oh, yes. But it's one of those things where you're resilient and feel that we're coming out the other side of it. Although during those 2 weeks of it, you're learning all sorts of coping skills.
Yeah.
I found there was a lot of interesting connection during this time. People were coming from all over. The smoke engulfed the whole city. The whole state. There really was nowhere you could go to get fresh air, to get away from it. Whether California was engulfed, Washington was engulfed, there was really nowhere to go to get fresh air. But a fascinating thing happened is even during the pandemic, a lot of people were going to donation centers and connecting that way and helping out individuals or groups. And in one of those times, whenever you look back and you go, what an interesting gift from all of that was, people were making new connections and feeling that they were actually doing something, where perhaps during the lockdowns of the pandemic and everything, people were feeling like, what can I do?
Right. And I always find it fascinating how people can show up in times of crisis and trauma. People, you know, it's easy to notice the people who disappoint us or whatever. But there are so many like really incredibly good-hearted people who will show up to help just because that's what they believe they should do, right?
And I think that's part of resilience. The idea that, I don't know if there's going into it expecting reciprocity, but this idea of this is what I'm supposed to be doing.
Mm-hmm.
It's an interesting thought to be able to show up like that. And I always applaud people that do go out there and in those times of trauma and need. We're just down to the last few minutes. I got to take one more final quick commercial break. And when we come back, we're going to talk some more. I just love that we're sort of all over the place. Everyone that knows the show knows I go down rabbit holes, and Dr. Lise is just a great one to ride along on this roller coaster with us. And so we'll be right back and talk more about resilience and building a strong platform for us to continue to optimize and rise above. We'll be right back.
Your conscious lifestyle on steroids. OM Times Radio. IOM FM.
Change and growth are part of natural life and also part of your spiritual life. Everyone needs support and guidance, especially during life passages. Upgrade yourself with the OM Times Experts program. With OM Times Experts, you have access to the best intuitive coaches, spiritual teachers, counselors, astrologists, and oracles. Our team was carefully selected so you can trust. Find out more at experts.omtimes.com.
Grab a cup of tea or a glass of wine and tune in for Inspired Conversations with publisher Linda Joy on Tuesdays at 2 p.m. Eastern. Linda creates sacred space for leading female luminaries, empowering authors, heart-centered female entrepreneurs, coaches, and healers. A soulful venue where guests openly share the fears and obstacles they've overcome, wisdom and lessons learned, and the personal journey that led them to the transformational work they do in the world. Inspired Conversations to empower you on your path to authentic, soulful living.
Research shows we apologize up to 10 times a day, and most of the time, we say sorry as a response to someone else's mistake. What if we thanked people instead of all that unnecessary apologizing? So instead of saying, sorry, I'm rambling, you say, thank you for listening. Join us at projectforgive.com, a free non-religious resource on global forgiveness.
Welcome back, everyone, to the Autoimmune Hour. I'm Sharon Sayler from SharonSayler.com. And tonight we've been talking with Dr. Lise Deguire. She's a clinical psychologist in private practice and author of just the astonishing book called Flashback Girl, Lessons in Resilience from a Burn Survivor. She was horrifically burned at 4 years old, and her tale starts then, and it's quite a gripping memoir, as well as a very action-based book on things that you can do too. I know, Dr. Lise, you call it a memoir, but I came away learning a lot too. It wasn't, some memoirs are just sort of like a trip down journey lane, you know, a journey down a lane. And this, your book isn't like that. I was really.
Yeah. I'm so glad you experienced it that way, because that was my hope. I didn't write this memoir just to write about myself. Obviously, it is about myself because it's my life. I alluded to this before. I believe that everyone can come through difficult circumstances. And if I did it, other people can do it too. And so my hope is that certainly by reading it, I mean, it's a good read. And I think people will feel inspired by the fact of my journey. But I also, there's actually lessons at the end of every chapter, a brief little lesson that, you know, encourages people, think about this, think about that, think about how you're handling these kind of relationships or this kind of situation, think about parenting. I wanted there to be some really clear takeaways for people, because that is really the point of it, is we can all survive things and thrive.
And as you were writing your memoir and reflecting back on it, as we said, resilience is sort of looking back, realize, oh, I did come through that. Okay. To me, at least, it's sort of a look back, a notion. It's not a forward thing. For me, it wasn't. It was looking back. Oh, yeah. Okay. I am resilient because I did make it through that. But as you were writing the book and learning more about the topic of resilience, what were a couple of the major surprising things that you learned about it?
So I think one of the things that is very important in resilience that came clear to me over time as I read and as I really thought about it, is it's the M&M, which I wanted to circle back to, the goals plus M&M, remember? Mm-hmm. So the M&M stands for meaning making. And meaning making, it turns out, is incredibly important in resilience. Because, and by the way, meaning making doesn't usually happen in the beginning of a problem. It happens as one is recovered and is rising up again. And the meaning making is the point where a person looks back and says, what have I learned from this awful thing? What have I learned from my suffering? What have I learned from this loss? What was I supposed to learn, or what have I learned? And how can I use that to enrich my life or other people's lives? So meaning making tends to be often easier if you are traditionally religious. Like, a lot of people then feel like, well, God wanted me to have this, or, you know, Jesus brought me here so that I could. And so people feel that way and think that way often. But you don't have to be religious to make meaning out of your experiences. And actually, by the way, sometimes people who are religious wind up having trouble making meaning because they think I was a good person. I did exactly what I was supposed to in the Bible. Why did this happen to me? So, but anyway, meaning making to me is, I'll give you an example from my experience. You know, again, I've had a horrendous, I would say, 3 decades, the first 3 decades of my life. Fire, disfigurement, you know, medical torture, essentially. I was bullied. I was rejected. My parents broke up. My parents were narcissistic. There were 4 suicides in my family. I mean, like, I could go on and on. And if you read the book, I will. But what did I learn from all of that? And so what I have learned from all of that is people suffer greatly. And it is my job to help people feel better. And I help them with the therapy that I do. That's been my journey for a long time, is being a good and kind and helpful psychologist. And now I'm doing it through my book, Flashback Girl. That's the meaning I make out of what I've been through. And I think everyone who wants a resilient recovery at some point needs to be able to look back and say, okay, what did I get from this? And other people will say, I learned to be more empathic, or I learned to be more generous, or I learned to be more grateful, or I could go on and on. But I'll stop and ask you what you think about what I'm saying.
Well, I absolutely agree. I think a long time listeners to the show know, why did I start the Autoimmune Hour? The major reason is my diagnosis had to make meaning for me. I had to make a meaning.
Right.
And so 4 months and still in the throes of losing skin and looking terrible and on heavy medication, 4 months after my diagnosis, I started the Autoimmune Hour.
Wow. And that was pretty quick.
Well, I'm one of those that have to make meaning pretty quick. I don't sit around a lot. And there was actually a bit of a self-serving reason too. I wanted to learn everything I could about this diagnosis, and not just the diagnosis of my label for autoimmune, but autoimmune.
Yeah.
And then I found out, gosh, I'm not alone. I think that was an odd one that on retrospect, I look back, part of me was feeling quite alone. No one in my world had an autoimmune condition. Goodness sakes, I had a family member hear the word autoimmune and it prescribed it to one thing. Oh my goodness, she must have AIDS. That's the only word they'd ever heard autoimmune with was that label. And this diagnosis of, I was trying to tell them there's hundreds of ways that the immune system can go crazy and wacky and things like that. And just that label that you have, this is an elderly person, you know, you have to give them grace and understanding that this was just not something that was in their world to them, that they were aware of. But that's the reason I started the show, really, was to make meaning. And I also, you know, we sometimes hear it like, what's the silver lining? Or people say, what are the gifts in what you went through? And I'm curious, as when you talk about the book, when I talk about the book and things, tell everyone where the title came from, Flashback Girl.
Okay, great. So we started off with how I found my picture in the U.S. Senate thing. So after that moment, that incredible moment, one of the things I found out in that moment is a sad thing, which is that I found out that the fire that I was in, that my mother set, and I'd always been told she set it accidentally using a lighter fluid that had been canned improperly. But what I found out in that moment too was that she hadn't actually used lighter fluid. It was a household solvent that she, I guess, thought was lighter fluid, and it was highly flammable. So the fact that it exploded all over us was no surprise, because it said on the can, highly flammable, do not use near fire and flame. So I discovered that, and that the story I had been told about the fire was not accurate. So I was dumbfounded, and I thought, well, I'm going to call this lawyer, you know, who was my lawyer when I was a kid, and find out what happened here. The lawyer, my lawyer, Edward Schwartz, had died, but his brother was in practice. And I called him and said, hi, I'm Lise Deguire. I blah, 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 blah. I was in this fire. Your brother represented me. And he said, are you the flashback girl? And I'm like, what? And he said, are you the flashback girl? I'm like, I guess. And so apparently my old lawyer and his brother, they'd lectured on my case for decades. Like they knew me, they knew my story. They knew everything about me. And I had no idea that, of any of this, let alone the fact that I had this quirky name, Flashback Girl. And that became the title of my book. And it's a good title, right? Because it's that. And also those of us who've been through trauma, many people have flashbacks. So it references that too. And the whole concept of flashing back as a memory, you know, you flash back to something. So I liked it. I thought it covered a lot of ground in two words.
It does cover a lot of ground. It's an amazing book, and I really urge people to get it and read it. And I have to admit, when it first popped across my desk, I have to say my first thought was flashback. It's a memoir. She's traveling in the past until I got into the story. And one of the things you talk about in your blog as well, and just in the last 6 minutes, I want to cover this because it was really a profound statement that you had in there about the release of telling your truth. And what happens when people give themselves permission to tell their truth?
Yes. You know, I mentioned that my parents were limited people through, you know, I would say no fault of their own, maybe some fault of their own, right? But that's how they were and that's who they were. They were limited people. And they were not people to ever allow the thought that they could be wrong or could be criticized in any way. So I'm a nice person. I'm a good girl. And I spent all my life just kind of trying to more or less make them happy. And I was not one then to criticize or find fault. But that what that meant was that I was holding a lot in about what really I had been through. And I'm not saying to say it to make it their fault or to criticize them, but the fact remains I was, you know, set on fire, abandoned in it, left alone in the hospital most of my childhood. My needs were neglected. My poor brother wound up taking his own life. I mean, we were not well taken care of. And to hold all that in all that time is very hard. And so it's a relief just to be able to say, yeah, this is what happened. Here I am. And to just be free to speak my truth.
Well, Dr. Lise, we're just about out of time, but I want to applaud you for sharing the book with me. It's an awesome book. I learned a lot. And I appreciate you having the courage to tell your truth in your story because it's a profound story. And bravo for coming out the other side to teach us all about the meaning of resilience and meaning making. I love meaning making. So we just down to the last 3 minutes. Any final thoughts also share with people where they can find your book?
Thank you so much. So I'm going to hold up this book. This is Flashback Girl. I would like to draw people's attention to the fact that that is a matchstick, a little flame coming off, and the flower is drawn on it in charcoal, which is, you know, from flame. So anyway, Flashback Girl, Lessons on Resilience from a Burn Survivor, and you can purchase it in Amazon or Barnes & Noble. You can purchase it in Book Depository in case you have people who are abroad. You can order it in your library. You can get it anywhere. And I would be so thrilled if you would, because I'd be honored to share my story.
And share your website with us as well.
Great. It's my name. So it's lisedeguire.com, which is spelled LiseDeguire. lisedeguire.com. Flashback girl.
And we'll have that on understandingautoimmune.com if you're driving or listening to it while you're exercising, like so many people like to tell me they do. Well, just go to Understanding Autoimmune and you'll find her website and all the information about her book and the show there as well. And also join us on Facebook and on YouTube as for those listening in audio, it's a beautiful bright yellow cover. You can't miss it when you put it in the name Flashback Girl into Amazon. It's the one with the bright yellow cover. You can't miss it. So everyone, that's Dr. Lise Deguire, and her book is called Flashback Girl: Lessons on Resilience from a Burn Survivor. And I'm Sharon Sayler from the Autoimmune Hour. So please join us next week for another brand new episode. As always, have a great week, whatever your adventures. Enjoy.
The information provided on the Autoimmune Hour, Understanding Autoimmune, and Life Interrupted Radio, including the websites understandingautoimmune.com and lifeinterruptedradio.com, plus social media, is for educational purposes only. What you read, hear, and see on the Autoimmune Hour, Understanding Autoimmune, and Life Interrupted Radio, and its websites and other media outlets, is based on experience only. The information should never be used for any legal, diagnostic, or treatment purposes. Always seek sound legal, medical, and or professional advice regarding any problems, conditions, and any of the recommendations you see, hear, or read here on the Autoimmune Hour, Understanding Autoimmune, and Life Interrupted Radio.
Hi, this is Sharon, and of course you know me from here on the Autoimmune Hour. Maybe you don't know I'm also an author. My latest book is for kids. It's Pinky Chenille and the Rainbow Hunters, a winner of a 5-star reader's favorite review. It's perfect for your early reader and a great bedtime story for your young adventurers. Check it out over at pinkychenille.com. That's PINKYCHENILLE.com. See you there. Do you want to be a better leader, have better relationships, become more self-aware, be a better communicator? Hi, I'm Sharon Sayler, best-selling author, professional speaker, and executive coach. And my life passion is empowering professionals to be the best that they can be. After years of working with professionals, I've discovered the 7 things nobody is telling you that can cost you your clients, sales, and even your career. And I want to give it to you free. You've heard my show, you know my passion, and maybe we'll be working together sooner rather than later. So go grab this ebook now to find out the 7 things that's costing you big time over at SharonSaylor.com/radio gift. Take a moment now to find a comfy spot. Wiggle about every nook and cranny to make sure you're comfortable in this spot. Shake out your fingers and wiggle your toes while you take some nice deep breaths and extend the exhale. Let it go with a sigh. That's right. And wander over to your favorite spot, you know the place. That place of safety and security in your mind, that you can just let your mind wander. And from this place, savor the smells and the colors, the textures and the patterns. That's right. Continuing to release any leftover little stressors of the day with a nice extended exhale. Coming to a place of complete comfort and relaxation. Letting go of all drama. All the need for drama. That's right. Just whisking it away. No longer needed. Doesn't have a place here. That's right. Just whisk it away. That's right. Oh, let it go with a sigh. No need for drama here. No need to accept others' drama. Just enjoying this place of solitude. Savor the colors and the textures and the patterns and just the quiet and comfort. on each extended exhale. Notice how it feels to be without drama. Oh, just lovely, that's right. Open and spacious without drama. That's right. Knowing that you can take the same feeling of open and spacious, no drama, no need for drama, right now, back into the real world. That's right. Integrate this feeling of no drama, of relaxation, open and spaciousness, and take it back into the present moment, right now, alert and aware that you can call on this feeling at any time and carry it with you at all times. That's right. Alert and aware, eyes wide open and ready to begin your day without drama and with that open and spacious feeling. Oh, welcome back.